Welcome back to Tamada's Table. Today we have a big project to accomplish. I'll show you how to make a big classic of Georgian cuisine, Hingali meat dumplings. You see, my platter is empty, but by the end of the show, it will be filled with large, juicy, succulent Hingali dumplings. Let's begin cooking. I begin with making the dough, because the dough is very simple. It's only water, flour, and salt. But at the same time, it's very tricky because we need a pliable and elastic dough and sturdy. Because what is Hingali? Georgian Hingali is a huge dumpling which holds broth inside. And to produce this broth, we need the dough which can hold it inside. So that's why we need really strong, sturdy dough. So I'll show you how. And first, I sifted my flour. So let's start. I will do it in the food processor, but of course you can do it with hands. So make a well in your flour and start adding water gradually. Georgians usually go to eat Hingali in the Hingali houses, which are small cafes across Georgia, and they are delicious and cheap. And so we don't usually make them at home, but all Georgians know how to make them because it's our favorite food. So let's start. My sifted flour is in the food processor. All I will be doing now is adding salt. So just run your machine, and while the food processor is running, I'll be adding warm water, and I will be adding it gradually. So let's start. So now you see, I took my dough from the food processor, and see, even food processor couldn't really, you know, combine all the ingredients well because the dough is dry. It doesn't have enough liquid. I will knead it for about 10 minutes with my hands. So it takes some muscle. That's why Hingali is usually teamwork. We invite our friends and they help us with kneading and rolling and folding. So you see how the dough looks after 10 minutes of kneading? It's not like soft and it's still like hard. So if I start rolling it now, it's not going to follow me. So right now this dough is very unfriendly. So what I'm going to do, I'll put it to rest for an hour in the dusted bowl, and I will cover it with plastic or clean cheesecloth or anything. Never leave this dough uncovered because it has so little liquid that it will dry immediately. Now I will be making the meat filling for the Hingali, and my ingredients are also very simple. I have my ground meat, which is the combination of beef and pork, the most commonly used for Hingali today. And I have my minced onion. It's about 2 small onions minced in the food processor. I have my chili pepper and I have my caraway seeds. So that's all I need, and salt and water. Actually, Hingali was the food of the shepherds because they lived in the mountains and the colder climate required this filling, nourishing food. And in the older times, the shepherds and the mountain dwellers, they used daggers to chop their meat. And it was typically lamb because they had pastures and of course they had a lot of sheep. Later, when Hingali moved to the cities, beef and pork came to be used, and fresh herbs were added to kalakuri or city-style Hingali. So first I will mix the ground meat with the onions. And then I will be adding, you know, some flavors. And one of the main flavors is red chili pepper, it's crushed, but you can use fresh green chili pepper. It will give amazing taste. And you can do, see, I'm adding only 1 teaspoon, but you can add more or less. Another main ingredient, which some cooks actually don't use, is caraway seeds, which I have here. About 1 teaspoon I will be adding to this meat filling, and it will give some specific taste which Hingali are known for. And now all I have to do is to mix these ingredients. Actually, it is easier to do it with your hands, and I will explain you why. Because you really need to mix the ingredients well until you will start adding some water. You know that Hingali are very juicy, right? And they have broth inside. So how to produce this broth? That's why cooks are usually adding water to the meat filling. So it will be soupy and loose, I mean the filling. And I recommend to use room temperature boiled water because it combines, somehow it combines better with the meat filling. But of course you can just use water from room temperature water. That's how you mix the water with the meat. And I will be adding more water because it's not yet as soupy as I need it to be. Okay. So this is my dough. You see, it's pliable. See, it's soft and it's elastic. So I will be making hinkali now. So we will cover 3 pieces of dough with the cheesecloth and we will be working with this one. You can see my roll, which is 5 inch long and it's proportionate in size. And I'm going to cut it into 1 inch pieces. One will be approximately 1.6, 1.7 ounces. And that's great size for hinkali. So these 5 pieces will become individual hinkali. And I will be rolling them now to about 5-6 inch rounds. So just work with one and cover the rest. So I will try, you know, to roll it from the center. Because if I roll it from the center, then the edges will be thinner than the center. And that's what we need for hinkali, because we will be putting the meat filling in the center, right? So let's do it this way. Okay, my roll is done. You can see that it's not too thin and it's not too thick. So I'll put it aside and I will work on the other rounds. Dust it with flour a little bit and put aside. So now it's time to fold or pleat hinkali, and all my rounds are here. You can see them. It's 20 of them from this amount of the dough. And now I'll show you how to pleat, how to fold hinkali. And I already dusted this board because I'll be putting my hinkali on the dusted with flour board. This is important because we don't want hinkali to stick to the board. I have one round and I'll put about 1 tablespoon of meat filling on it. Now all I have to do is to pleat hinkali. So I will put the dough up and then I will start pleating. One pinch, fold, pinch, fold, pinch, fold, pinch, fold, pinch, shake. So it kind of like creates this small basket for the meat filling. Again, fold, pinch, fold, pinch. So with my this finger, I am pinching the fold, each fold. See, fold, pinch, fold, pinch, fold, pinch. Shake again, so it's the meat filling is in the center of the basket. See? Some people say that it should be 19 folds. Some people say that it should be 29 folds. So you see that I was also pinching. When I finished folding, pleating, I was like pinching here. And then, simple, we will just cut the top. That's why I told you that the round doesn't have to be perfect. And I will put it hinkali on the floured board. So now this next one, I will put the heaped tablespoon of meat in front. And again, we will start folding. One pinch, pleat, pinch, pleat, pinch. It gives very nice folds to the hinkali and it holds the meat filling inside. So this one has 19 pleats. And again, cut the top. So I have 2 trays with 10 hinkali on each, and this I will cook and this will go to the freeze. I'll put it in the freeze for about 2 hours on this board, which I dusted very well with the flour. And in 2 hours, the hinkali will become solid. And that will be the time when you can take hinkali and put them into the airtight bag, plastic bag. And then you can keep for a couple of months in your freeze. And you know, whenever you want, you take them out and you start cooking. And you cook them in the normal way, the same way I'll show you now. So my water is boiling and it's time to start putting hinkali in. And it's about 2/3 of water in this pot. It's the biggest pot I have. If you have bigger pot, then use it. But first put 1 tablespoon of salt and then mix it. And we will be boiling hingali in the salted water. So take your hingali by the top and very gently whirl into the water, like that. So I put all my 10 hingali in. There is no space for more, because I told you before that hingali should not stick to each other. They should have enough space and not to be overcrowded. Now, if you want to prevent the hingali from sticking, you can shake and move the pot like that. Or you can use your wooden spoon and just very, very gently, you know, move them a little bit so they don't stick to the bottom. Very, very gently. Now bring to the boil on the high medium and count 7 minutes after the water starts to boil. 7 minutes after the water starts to boil, your hingali are ready. Hey, let's check on our hingali. It's been 7 minutes after the water started to boil. Okay, yes, they are ready. They are all on the top. And now, very gently, I will be taking them out because I don't want them to tear. So that's one. Oh, ho, ho, ho. This is my plate of steaming hingali. Yeah. What is good about hingali? That hingali is the meal in itself. Why? Because hingali has 3 dishes in one. It has soup, broth, it has bread, the dough, and it has the meat. So what else you need? That's why Georgians just pepper hingali with black pepper and enjoy. And the main art to eating hingali is to make first a small bite, because we like to eat them when they are hot. So how you can really touch these wonderful hingalis? Now I'll show you how to eat hingali, because there is some art to eating hingali. So I'll take it by kuchi. Kuchi is this handle which you usually discard. Georgians don't eat it. And then you give a small bite from the side, like. And after I give a small bite, I will slurp all the delicious broth which is inside the hingali. And then I will eat the rest. So watch me. So it's juice inside, and I don't want even to lose one drop of this juice. So that's how we eat hingali. As I told you from the beginning, my tray was empty. Now my tray is full of delight. This is my steaming plate of hingali, and Georgians typically have hingali with beer or a shot of homemade vodka chacha in Georgian language, which is made from grapes like grappa or from other fruit. Please enjoy with your family and friends. Come back for my weekly postings. Let's have fun together. Let's cook together. Let's be friends. Bon appétit! Gabriela Dumirco!